Hello, and welcome back to the How to Build a Multiplayer Game Framework, brought to you by CJR Gaming. My name is Christian Richards. In the last video, we covered our config and our application portions, where we set up our initial application interface, as well as several of the config files. In this video, we're going to take a look at our messaging section. This is going to encompass several classes for those who went through the first framework that seem very similar. In fact, they are almost identical. So we'll just go ahead and jump right in. Let's take a look at the overall structure of our messaging system. We'll begin with the three different message types. First, we have a request, which is clients sending requests to the server to do something. Things like movement, things like I want to harvest that item, I want to cast this spell, attack this mob, so on and so forth. Those are all requests. After that, we have our responses, which are things that the server is telling the client back in response to a request that the client has done. This might be something like that item is taken already, you can't do that right now, things along those lines. And then the last thing we have is our async messages. Those are messages that come from the server that are things that are done outside of a request that a client has made. They're usually in response to other clients making requests, things like other players moving, the AI causing an attack, casting a spell, updating the stats such as when a tick occurs and you get some health regen, things along those lines. That leads us to our next part, which is our overall messaging system. You can see from this diagram that we will have pretty much the same setup we had before. We have iHandlers, which will handle each of those three different message types coming in. We'll have a set of default handlers that will handle things in the instance where we don't have a handler set up or where we want something to occur no matter what kind of message is coming in if something else hasn't already handled it. Those will all be handled by an iHandler list, which is then broke out into two concrete classes, our client handler list and our server handler list. As the names state, the client handler list will handle things from the client. The server handler list will be used anytime we are receiving messages between servers, which would be any server past the proxy server, as well as inter-server communication. So if one server is communicating to another server, those same kind of things will be handled by that server handler list. The client handler list will only facilitate calls from the client and not calls between the servers. Let's take a look at the code. We're going to begin by creating that message type enumeration that we saw before. I'm going to begin by creating this as a class, and we're just going to call it message type. The idea being that we're going to describe each of those three message types inside of this class. First, I'm going to change it to be an enumeration, though, rather than a class. And that's because we're going to use this throughout the program, along with this attribute here called flags. The flags attribute allows us to use any combination of these things at the same time. And that'll be used mainly in our messages themselves. Here I'm going to define each of the three different types. We're going to start with request, and I'm going to use the hexadecimal notation of 0x1 for that. Next, we have our response, which is going to be 0x2. And then lastly is the async, which is going to be 0x4. Now, the reason for these is so that we can distinctly identify any one of those or all three of those as being handled by a specific message handler. Next, we're going to go ahead and create our iMessage class. This is going to be our base message class from which all three of those types are going to be derived. I begin by making it public so that we can use it elsewhere in the framework. And I'm going to start by adding a message type called type. Now, that is so that each of our messages, when we define the concrete classes, can be defined by a specific type. I'm only giving it a getter and not a setter as well. And as you can see, I also include that using statement for the multiplayer game framework implementation messaging there. The next piece we have is our byte code, which is going to be used for differentiating between each of our different messages. followed that by the subcode. I mark that as a nullable int because there are times where we don't want it to have a specific subcode, and there are times where we do want it to have a specific subcode. After that, I have a dictionary which has a byte and object pair for our different parameters. The reason for that is I don't want to have duplicate parameters in each of these things. Instead, I want each one to be uniquely defined by a byte, and then it can have any object held within it rather than calling out specific objects. And we'll be able to play with that a little more later. Now that we have our iMessage interface done, we're going to go ahead and create our next interface. This one is going to be called iHandler, and the iHandler is going to be our generic definition for all of our handlers. I begin by marking it public, and then I give it this funky caret with a T in the middle of them. And the idea is that we'll be able to tell this handler what this object is later on in the future. Next, I go ahead and I add in that message type so that this handler knows what type of messages it will handle. Now, this one could handle just requests, just responses, or any of the combination of the three. Next, we have our byte code so that it knows what code it's supposed to look for if it's going to handle that message, as well as our nullable int for the subcode, meaning if it has no subcode, it's going to handle any message. If it has a subcode, it's going to look for that specific subcode. Next, we're going to create a Boolean returned function, which I'm just going to call handleMessage. It's going to take in any kind of iMessage, because again, we're going to be differentiating that by that message type at the top. And then it's going to take in that funky T with the peer there. Now, what this means is that these have to match. At some point later on in the future, I'm going to give it a peer, and it's going to accept that type. Now, that's going to be important when we create this next class, our iHandler list. And the reason for that is because we want all of our handlers to match the same type when it's in one of these handler lists. I begin by making it public, just as the last time. And then I go ahead and I add that same caret T close caret, or rather greater than, less than. And then I go in and I add this first function. It's going to return a Boolean. It's called registerHandler. And it's going to take in some type of handler. Again, that T is going to match up. So it's either going to be, in our case, a client or a server that this handler list will work with. Next, we have our other bool, which is going to be handleMessage. It's going to receive an iMessage, and it's going to take in that T peer as well. And that's so that we know whether or not we have a handler that can handle that message. Now that we have our iHandler and iHandler list interfaces defined, we're going to cover the last three interfaces we'll do in this video. The first one is going to be called iDefaultEventHandler, and it's going to be a pretty simple interface. We're not actually going to define much in it. We're just going to mark it as public. We're also going to add our generic to the end of it, so our greater than, less than with the T in the middle, and it's going to inherit from an iHandler with the same T definition. We're really not doing much more than that. We really just want this to be pretty plain and generic. We're going to create the same thing for the iDefaultRequestHandler. And the reason we're doing this is so that later on, when we get into our default handlers, we can define them more easily. As I said when I first started out, we want this to be a little bit more well-defined with AutoFac. And the way we do that is by defining these interfaces. So we've got our iDefaultRequestHandler done now. Next, we just need our iDefaultResponseHandler. Again, same thing, just detail it as public, give it the generic T at the end, and then have it inherit from iHandlerT. And when we get to the concrete classes for these, it'll become a little more apparent why we're just using generics rather than just creating the concrete classes. Again, it's primarily so that we, the developers, can define these things later and AutoFac will pick up on them. With our interfaces covered, we're going to go ahead and stop the video this evening. In our next video, we're going to begin looking at the actual concrete versions of our event request response messages, as well as our client and server handlers and handler lists. I look forward to seeing you next week. Till then.